Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to day two, our Foundations for Teaching and Learning about Native Americans. You are on day two of our session, which is how to tell more complete narratives about Native peoples in your classroom. So we welcome you, and we saw so many people already from across the country. So we're really delighted that you've joined us today. And we want to start out today by asking you to use the chat and tell us where you live and where you're zooming in from if you haven't already. And we saw people from, I saw people from all 50 states, I think Portugal, Canada, I saw Switzerland and Germany, many sovereign nations. We saw Laguna and Zuni Pueblo. We saw the Yokuts and Diné people. We saw Eagle Butte, South Dakota, Gallup, New Mexico. We want to welcome everybody from around all 50 states and across the nation today. Thanks for joining us. Today I'm coming in from my home in Fairfax City, Virginia. My name is Renee Goki, and I'm a citizen of the Eastern Shawnee Tribe of Oklahoma. I'm also the Teacher Services Coordinator at the National Museum of the American Indian, where I've been for about 20 years. I have the pleasure of designing and delivering a variety of educational programs for students and teachers. And today I'm looking forward to trying something sort of new for us at the museum. We're going to adapt a program that we've done for a few years at the museum where we have groups of teachers, you know, on site usually, and we have all these primary and secondary sources. And we have teachers kind of assess and work through these sources and ask questions of them to reach towards more complete narratives. So my favorite part is always hearing from teachers themselves. And this will be the first time that we're virtual, so we look forward to hearing from you. And also the fact that we have more teachers joining us today, is we're really excited about that as well. So to begin our session, and I saw in the chat already some of you are acknowledging the Indigenous peoples on whose land you live. And this feeling of belonging and this idea of belonging to the land or a place or a homeland and your family or groups, these are such important concepts. And so I'd like to share the National Museum of the American Indians land acknowledgement, which are traditionally orally spoken. We gratefully acknowledge the Native peoples on whose ancestral homelands we gather, as well as the diverse and vibrant communities who make their home here today. For many Indigenous people, belonging is deeply tied to our ancestral homelands through relationships with the environment, through memories and cultural experiences lived over millennia. In the United States, people are increasingly doing these kinds of land acknowledgments, and they can be spoken or written and are meant to recognize that Indigenous peoples are the original stewards of the lands on which we now live and work. These acknowledgments should always be motivated by genuine respect for and support of Native peoples. Acknowledging original Indigenous habitants is really complex, you know, even here in Fairfax City where I live, because of centuries of displacement experienced by Native peoples. Throughout our histories, many Native groups have been forcibly removed, whether by policy or relocated on their own to try and avoid assimilation. So there's so many strategies that Indigenous people have had. And they've, you know, successfully adapted to these new places and environments, such as cities, rural areas, and reservation communities. I mentioned earlier that I'm Eastern Shawnee, and my own community was forcibly removed from a reservation in Ohio in September of 1832, and my grandparents moved again after they were born and raised in Oklahoma out to the Pacific Northwest, and I saw somebody from Portland, Oregon, which is they lived outside of there to for jobs after the Great Depression to find work there. And I know this is true of so many families, this idea of a relocation. Land acknowledgments are a first step in creating these types of collaborative, accountable, and respectful relationships with Indigenous Native nations and communities. So we hope that you might think about this practice, but we certainly want it to come from a real place of respect, and just to emphasize again that it's a first step in the process.
Thank you, Renee. So my name is Johanna Grelick, and I'm the manager of the Education Department at the National Museum of the American Indian. Many of you likely already do land acknowledgments in your classroom, You may also use imagery, text, videos, and other media in your classroom when you're doing your American Indian units. So today what we're going to do is model strategies for understanding how best to assess that imagery, those objects, and the media about American Indians to assure that they're culturally sensitive and relevant to the goals of your lessons. We're going to introduce you to a framework which can serve as a benchmark to guide you how to select materials. But before we look at some imagery, I'd like to introduce you to our museum and to the work we do. So here you see our place of work. We work at the National Museum of the American Indian, which is part of the Smithsonian Institution. It's a complex of museums, libraries, research centers, and even a zoo. We have two exhibition locations. Renee is based in Washington, D.C. on the National Mall, which is here on your left. And I work in New York City in Lower Manhattan. The museum's collection is housed at the Cultural Resources Center in Suitland, Maryland. So one of the most common questions that we get is about why we're called the National Museum of the American Indian. We know that the term American Indian is a very general way to describe indigenous cultures and communities in the Western Hemisphere. We also know that there are nearly 600 federally recognized tribes in the United States alone. Each has its own history, social and political structure, cultural practices and language. Since our museum represents Native people from the entire hemisphere, you can understand why a term like American Indian or Native American is really inadequate to describe the vast diversity that exists among and between Native peoples. So for the purposes of today's talk, we're going to be using the terms American Indian and Native American interchangeably. They're not perfect terms, but we use them when we're talking broadly about Native Americans. We will provide you with a one-page handout called The Impact of Words. And this handout will further describe tips for choosing appropriate language when speaking about Native Americans.
Thanks, Johanna. Central to the museum's mission are strategic partnerships with Native peoples and collaborations with classrooms and people like you across the country. Your efforts to teach our students more complete narratives helps advance our goal to foster a more informed understanding of Native peoples, as you see in our mission. And our museum has recently adopted this vision statement: equity and social justice for the Native peoples of the Western Hemisphere through education, inspiration, and empowerment. Changing systems of schooling and society, plus individual people's assumptions or stereotypes, doesn't happen overnight. In fact, just last week, I was reading about the process of working to change the Washington area sports team name. Suzanne Harjo shared her story of work that began in 1962 when Clyde Warrior, a Ponca, visited her high school senior class and informed and inspired her class about the mascot at the University of Oklahoma called Little Red and the problems with that. Clyde also mentioned at that time what he said was the worst one of all in our nation's capital. And this one talk in that classroom inspired Suzanne and helped really change the course of history. Little Red was abandoned in 1970, and for over 40 years, Suzanne worked to change the Washington area sports team. She's one of my sheroes. Through litigation and various defendants and bringing on new generations of young people to take up the fight, they work together and with allies, this change finally became a reality this month in July. And we know that this type of work begins with giving voice to Native peoples and helping create bridges on where dialogue and inspiration and ultimately understanding can flourish. We feel honored to work in education, and our National Education Initiative is at the heart of our work to make social justice rights become a reality. So we really want to thank you for this partnership.
So here you see the landing page of our Native Knowledge 360 website, which is intended for teachers and students. And if you joined us yesterday, you heard Ed Schupman speak about the two textbook studies that our department conducted in 2012 and 2015. The results revealed that Native American histories accounted for only a small handful of pages in each textbook. They were largely confined to the past, to pre-1900 events, and were relegated to only 8 to 10 moments in history. None of them provided Native accounts of the events that were featured, and they were generally told in really broad terms. So given the fact that there are over 600 unique Native nations in the United States alone, we know that this approach clearly misses some critical moments in Native history. So the National Museum of the American Indians Native Knowledge 360 initiative wants to fill some of these gaps by creating classroom-ready materials that include first-person narratives, photographs, videos, objects from our collection, and other assets that engage students in a multi-sensory approach to learning. Our lessons are all standards aligned and they're cross-disciplinary. A guiding force for this work is our essential understanding framework that provides key concepts when teaching about Native peoples. And if you could show the next slide, please. The essential understandings provides the benchmarks and language that helps support you in your classroom. And that's the tool that we're going to be using today.
So now we'd like to focus on the resources that you use in your classroom environment. So we're going to bring up a poll. What criteria do you apply when determining the types of resources you use to teach your students about Native peoples? Books or handouts written by Native people, materials are historically accurate, you include present day people and are not, the resources are not only written in the past, materials describe a variety, a diversity of Native experiences. Maybe you get resources from colleagues or conferences. Or you might not have a framework for selecting materials. So let's see what our results are here.
That's great. Look at how many people are using books or handouts written by Native people. It's fantastic. Making sure that materials are historically accurate, phenomenal. That's present fantastic. Day people, that's terrific, good. This is amazing. Mm-hmm. And some people don't have a framework and that's okay too. Mm-hmm.
That's really great. Well, today it's great to hear all of the variety. Today we're gonna use NMEI's framework for essential understandings as a tool to assess some of the resources and benchmark them against our key concepts. It's important to know this isn't a curriculum, but instead it's a tool or a framework that follows the National Council for Social Studies 10 themes that they've laid out. And it helps to provide language and ways of thinking when teaching about Native Americans. So we hope it's a good tool for you. Today we'll highlight essential understanding number one, again following the National Council for Social Studies theme, which is culture. This provides us some key concepts that can help inform our choices of resources. For example, you see there's no single American Indian culture or language in the middle there as that point. So classroom resources should provide and name a variety of diverse cultures, both past and present. And that naming, as we know in social justice, is really important. We want to show Native American cultures as both diverse from each other and changing over time, just as other groups do. For example, Native Americans aren't in leather and feathers every day, just as English women no longer wear corsets and thankfully don't paint their faces in mercury. The Serbians, as another example, and Italians are as different from each other as the Miamia people from Indiana and Ohio and the Lummi people of Washington State. It's okay to share similarities between Native American groups, and we know that that's often a place where people start, particularly in elementary classrooms. So that's fine. There are some eras that, you know, really affected most Native people. For example, federal Indian policies such as removal and the treaty making period and allotment or termination, just to name a few. There are also boarding school experiences that many of our grandparents experienced as well. So there are shared experiences. Like all cultures today, Native identity is shaped by many complex social, cultural, and political factors. If you layer onto that idea that not one Shawnee experience is the same, you'll find that I can't be a representative of the Shawnee people for all Shawnee people, and certainly not all Native people. So it's always important to recognize that. Today, we'd like to model what the inclusion of more complaint narratives may look like in your classroom. And we'll start by thinking about three types of narratives: false, incomplete, and more complete. So let's start with defining what a false narrative is. We're actually going to do a word cloud now. What is one word you would use to describe a false narrative? So you're going to go to menti.com and you can use your phone or you can open up a tab on your computer and use the code 152902. So again, the code, no need to fret, take your time, 152902 is the code. And we're going to see what you have to say about what a false narrative it means to you.
Okay. You can be very specific or you can be very broad in your approach. So you can use a word or you can use an experience.
That's right.
Oh my gosh.
Biased. I'm seeing biased as really holding
strong. Misleading. Lies.
Propaganda.
Racist.
Inaccurate.
Oh, great.
Damaging. Yes. Ed talked about that yesterday. Ignorance. Harmful. One-sided. Lies. Phew.
Wow. Well, it seems that everybody seems to know what a false narrative is, so that's great. So clearly a false narrative is one that typically has a bias or an agenda associated with it. False narratives often rely on generalities and are inaccurate or incomplete representations. Many false narratives, we have to be careful about them because they can be hurtful. They reinforce stereotypes, and as Ed showed yesterday, they can even promote prejudice. So what we want to do today is look at a source that represents a false narrative. Okay, so the characters in this image are likely very familiar to most of you. This is an image by Charles Schultz of Snoopy and Woodstock celebrating Thanksgiving. This image is actually currently on view at the National Museum of the American Indian in Washington, D.C. in the Americans exhibition. And it's also online, which is where I got this from. This type of image is very common during Thanksgiving. And since so many of our students see images like this, it's important to understand why it's so problematic. With any source, we really want to learn as much as we can about it. So we created a slide of some questions that we might pose of source materials. We might ask, who made the object if we know, or image? Was it a Native person? Do we know the intended purpose or the use of this object? And is there an intended audience for this object or image? So what we're going to do is we're going to use the same approach to investigate this image today. And one question I have, if you can put in the chat, is in this image, the illustrator clearly uses an element or several elements that he's supposed to be, that's supposed to be identifiable as representing Native Americans. Can you indicate in a word or a phrase what you think Schultz used to identify? Oh, great. Oh my gosh, feathers, headdresses, great. Okay, here we go.
Corn,
oh good. Yeah. No, somebody noticed the popcorn in the back. That's fantastic.
Yeah. Food,
good,
yeah.
That is good. Okay, so why would the illustrator, why would Charles Schultz put this headdress on Woodstock? Often when we see representations of Native people, they're shown wearing this type of headdress. While many Native nations have feather headdresses, one like this is particular to Native people of the plains. It's typically made of eagle feathers and would be earned by the wearer for his valor, bravery, generosity, or another characteristic deemed worthy by his community. Yet when people think of or even represent American Indians, they often depict them wearing this type of headdress. So this is an opportunity for us to learn about why this particular type of headdress, why is it so representational of American Indian identity? Well, there's actually a historical reason for it. And it happens after the Battle of Little Bighorn in Montana in 1876. This becomes the moment that Plains Indians became a stereotyped image representing all Native Americans. Soon after the defeat of George Custer and 200 of his men by Lakota and Northern Cheyenne, the battle started to be reenacted in stage presentations, in pageants, and later, of course, in movies and on television. And as printing technology advanced, images of Indians wearing plain-style feather headdresses circulated on posters, postcards, and other imagery. And it was used to sell products, as you see here. And these images also come from the Americans exhibition in Washington, D.C. And these types of images became famous around the world. So let's road test this image using our essential understanding number one. And we're using this as an assessment tool. So if we note the way in which the headdress is shown here, it really erases diversity. It does not show the vast complexity and diversity of Native cultures across the Americas. Many people represent generic versions of American Indians during Thanksgiving because it's supposed to reference a gathering that took place in 1621 between Pilgrims and the Wampanoags, who are based in Massachusetts. The Wampanoags do not have a tradition of wearing this style headdress. This style of illustration really shows a cartoonish version of both the Indians and the Pilgrims. Now, one thing to remember about these types of images, as Ed noted yesterday, is that while we really want to show students and understand why false narratives are so problematic, we want to be very mindful that these type of images can be hurtful, particularly to Native students, because they serve to undermine the ability of Native Indian nations and their allies to portray accurate and respectful images of their cultures and traditions. So now let's turn our attention to another image.
Thanks, Johanna. We're going to look today at a headdress, and we're going to look carefully at this headdress from NMAI's collection. Today, we're going to use a strategy maybe you've heard of or used in your own classroom. It's a visual thinking strategy from Harvard's Project Zero, which has a lot of great resources for close looking. It's called See, Think, Wonder, and it's one of my favorites. It's quite simple, but what we'll do is we're going to take about 20 to 30 seconds, and I'd like you to just carefully observe and notice details. You see sort of a profile image of the headdress, and then you see the back of the headdress as well. So this, as you're doing it and just looking carefully, before you sort of jump ahead and ask questions, just notice things. Just use your eyes to move kind of over the object and notice smaller details. What I like about this visual thinking strategy is it really encourages active processing of information, and it helps make everyone's thinking more visible in classrooms. It's also, I think, a tool that can help with equity. It lends itself to hearing from different voices and in your setting as well. There's sort of no wrong answer, right? People are just observing what they see. So when I look at this, I see a long headdress with small sort of pale yellow ribbons on the edges. I don't know if any of you saw that as well. There's perhaps 70 or more white feathers. I have not counted them, but it looks to be about that many. And they're attached to the crown of the headdress and running down the entire length of a red wool or broadcloth fabric that the feathers are somehow attached to. I also see some beadwork. I see some blue and different colors there at the top, and white sort of hanging ermine or rabbit skins, perhaps. I see they look sort of soft to me in the picture. So those are just some of the observations that I had, and I'm sure you could add to that as well. But what are some things that we recognize, and what information might we want to add to help to make this a more complete narrative? By using close observation and inquiry, we can start to build more complete narratives. And this is a little bit of the messy work of history. But we're going to layer on one bit of information, and that's the catalog card that you see here. According to the catalog, this was made by the Southern Cheyenne or Zitzistas people and Arapaho tribes. It doesn't cite a particular maker on the catalog card. So this headdress could really be incomplete or more complete, depending on how we use it and the questions that we may ask of it. We see that it was given to Senator Inouye and later gifted to the museum from his wife, Irene Inouye. I still have a lot of questions myself about this headdress and where might one begin as you have these questions in your classroom. We recommend starting your research with the tribe's website. So it's important to note that Southern Cheyenne history and culture is not very familiar to me. Although my family and I are Eastern Shawnee, as I mentioned, each culture, as you know by now, is diverse and unique. And there's much diversity among and within even the three federally recognized Shawnee groups. As a Native person, it would be impossible to have a good understanding of all of the almost 600 federally recognized tribes that Johanna mentioned. And that's not even talking about the almost, I believe, 2,000 in the Western Hemisphere. But to go back to this object and the website, I learned on their website, the Cheyenne and Arapaho, they're now in Western Oklahoma, and they were closely affiliated and then joined together around the year 1813. I started to wonder about the Northern Cheyenne and how the people came to be in different geographic regions, since I have a friend who grew up in Lame Deer, Montana, in Southeast Montana. So I wondered about those questions and as well. And I found out from the website that their people had been geographically separated for many years, but always aligned culturally. Another strategy that you might try in your classroom, and we hope you do, is NMEI's NK360 website. So I put in under lessons and resources the search term Cheyenne, and I learned something important when I put that in. I saw a beautiful picture of a sacred place to the Cheyenne people called Bear Butte. At Bear Butte, a man named Sweet Medicine, which is in reference, I found out, to the sweet grass, gained knowledge that led to the formation of the four Cheyenne military societies and their 44 chiefs. So that alone brought so much information about the political nature and the government and the complexity of how they organize themselves. You can learn much more about Northern Cheyenne traditions and culture on our NK360 website, which you see here, and we have pronunciation tools for you. I know that's a really good, powerful tool in your classroom just to overcome that discomfort of not wanting to say the wrong thing. So that's helpful. We also have maps of homelands. We have stories, as I mentioned to you, and you can actually hear a Northern Cheyenne person tell that story. Rich photographs, both historic and contemporary, and a lot of fantastic videos that students seem to really connect with in the classroom. So let's go back to the headdress. This is a type of headdress that's worn by leaders in Cheyenne communities, particularly those in service to their people. And they also recognize accomplishments that an individual has made over many years and sometimes over a lifetime. Often these are chiefs and leaders of particular societies, and they're almost always male. Although, and this is where the messy part comes in, as I started to read more, I read that there are exceptions to that rule. For example, a woman might wear this, a family member's, in very unique circumstances to honor her husband. So that, it, you know, that is, there are always exceptions as you read and learn more. There's always more to know. I received my first eagle feather when I graduated high school, and it was from a family member. And my second one was given to me about 4 or 5 years later when I worked with youth in my own community. So you can imagine that a person who has collected and received all of these honors, it's truly something to behold. And it carries a lot of respect with it, with this headdress. So the next question naturally is, you know, let's learn a little bit more about Senator Inouye and the people around him. So I found this photograph. It's from 1989, May 8th. And there are a couple of people to note in this photograph. Suzanne Harjo, who's Hodolgi Muskogee in Southern Cheyenne, who I mentioned earlier is one of my sort of men, you know, people I look up to for all that she's done. She passed the American Indian Religious Freedom Act in 1978. So that was an instrumental in protecting religious freedom and actually the right to go to sacred places as well as hold feathers and things like that and practice traditional ceremonies, which were outlawed for many years. She also brought back millions of acres of land and brought it back into possession for Native people. Senator Inouye, who you see smiling and looking squarely into the camera, who's standing in the back to the right of Suzanne, he was instrumental on several important policies supporting Native rights and representation. And he also signed the National Museum of the American Indian Act of Congress. And you actually see a signing of this, the transfer of collections from New York City and into the Smithsonian Institution and establishing the National Museum of the American Indian. I've heard he is a quiet person, a humble person. So we'll take a look at the next picture of him. Ben Knighthorse Campbell, actually, who had this wonderful quote, because I wanted to find out more about him as a person. And so Ben Knighthorse Campbell, a former senator of Colorado, had this to say about Senator Inouye. He was a warrior among chiefs. A warrior among chiefs. So he stood very, very tall in the eyes of the people. His quiet demeanor and gentle way, his leadership and perseverance, his record as a military hero for our nation, and years of service in the US Senate are well known to all. So through layering these different sources, such as quotes and photos and Native voices, we can see this incredible gift that was given to the late Senator Inouye and the importance behind it. This gift to Inouye shows the leadership values that the Cheyenne people hold dear. And there's still so much more to know. So in contrast to the cartoon that Johanna showed us earlier, this object is an example of the key concepts listed in the essential understandings that Native American cultures have always been dynamic and changing and are ongoing today. Obviously, I still have so many wonderings about this headdress, such as if Senator Inouye ever wore it. I wonder about his reaction when he received it. That curiosity and the wonderings of your students can help guide their interest and further your research together to work towards more complete narratives. So now we're going to hear from you. Let's turn to the chat. What questions do you have about this object, or what questions might your students have? And we won't be able to answer all of them, but we're seeing a few here. Is it heavy? That's a good question. People who have handled it would know that. It's certainly a lot of feathers. How was it made? I wondered that too. When would someone wear it? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Certainly it opens up a lot of questions.
People are asking about the colors and what they represent. Do people still wear headdresses like this?
Yes, yeah, I believe people still do. When they've earned these types of headdresses, they are still worn today. And some people ask, you know, when are these worn? It's important to know that, you know, these were never worn in battle. But they are worn probably for very special occasions, whether it's traditionally representing your people in a special society, maybe a ceremony, maybe a public event where a leader may wear something like this.
Renee, there's a great question here about why it's in the museum. And this was a gift to the museum, right?
Yes, it was a gift.
Mm-hmm. By Inouye's wife, is that correct?
That's right, yeah. So it was a very nice gift to the museum. Thank you guys for all these great questions about it. Yeah.
Yeah, these are amazing questions and great to think about what your students might be asking of objects or images and how that can generate a more complete narrative, the more research that they do into it. There was a question here too, I think a couple of people asked is, people are pleased to know that it's not inappropriate to show these kinds of headdresses in their classrooms. And that's correct. It's okay to show this type of headdress and do this type of research with your students. And if you don't know all the answers, you can see the type of research that Renee did to learn more about it.
And just to add to that, Johanna, just so people know, you know, there are different cultural values and understandings of these, for lack of a better term, objects, but really they represent cultural values and are seen often as living, breathing, ancestral things, and ancestors too. And so it's important to know that we don't put things up on our website that would be inappropriate to share. So you can kind of rest assured that if we're showing something, we have worked with the community and gotten permission to do so. But those are really good questions.
Great. And people want to know where they might be able to find this particular headdress. And this is in the museum's collection. And you can find the museum's collection if you go to the museum's website and you can search the collection items. And you can even look for this particular one. You could search by Cheyenne or you can search by Inouye.
I just saw a great comment, Johanna, that I wanted to share from Heather McGrew, who I know actually, hello. She said that it's great to model that, you know, that you don't have all the answers and that you're not necessarily an expert and that you can learn together. So we really appreciate that comment, Heather, thank you. Yeah, that's a good point. You know, we're building communities of learners, right? So when we kind of make ourselves a little bit vulnerable in the classroom, but have that growth mindset and apply that to ourselves, just like we're being asked to apply to our students, then, you know, it creates, I think, a really good atmosphere for learning together.
That's great. All right. So let's go to our final source today, which is actually a video from one of our own lessons, our NK360 lessons called Northern Plains History and Culture, How Do Native People and Nations Experience Belonging? And you'll learn more about this lesson tomorrow if you come back to participate in the webinar with Colleen Smith. What we're gonna do today is we're gonna watch this video and then once again, we're gonna road test it with our essential understanding.
We're not just Indians out here, some kind of sociological phenomenon out here. We are tribes. We're nations of people, nations who possess land.
The connection to the land, as this is what sustains us, this is what provides for us, this is what makes us alive. So the connection between the person and the land was extremely strong.
It was lifelong tradition. It's been with us. It's in our spirit. It's in our DNA. It's who we are. And it's to protect our homeland. And people love, you know, this country, love this land.
This is an area that is so sacred to the tribe. This is where we believe that the Creator came down and met with our people within this mountain. It's called Bear Butte, South Dakota. And from there, we were given our cultural ways, our values, our norms, and our laws.
We love ceremony. We know what it's about and what it's for, and we embrace it. You know, we're not financially rich or materially wealthy. We just know that we're here for each other. We care for each other deeply. And we love each other and we live for each other. And I want my young people to be able to withstand and overcome any kind of trauma and hardship that they might encounter in their young lives, to thrive and to be proud of who they are, to seek out the true meaning of their identity and their purpose for being here in this time and space.
Elizabeth Cook Lynn.
Marilyn Hudson.
Darren Oldkyle.
Gail Small.
It's Anthony, Prairie Bear.
Okay, so this is just a taste of one of our resources. And like I said, you'll learn more about this tomorrow but we'd like to open again up for the in the chat and find out from you what you think made this video a more complete narrative. Great personal perspectives, multiple Native voices, their own voices, connection to the land.
Contemporary, modern. Mm-hmm. Great.
Imagery. Okay, oral explanations, great.
Community, genuine.
Connection, love that. Linked past and present. So you saw that continuity of culture. That's terrific. Not white people talking for Native people. That's great. First person.
Ceremony, personal.
Great. Great. This is really great. So what we're going to use is our assessment tool again, and we're going to bring back our essential understanding, number one. And you can see here how our resources are created using this as our benchmark. So we have many individual voices. We're showing personal perspectives. It's in the present tense, their actual locations. At the end of the video, you saw people are actually named and their tribal affiliations are noted. And so we're very careful to use our essential understanding in the way that we're suggesting that you might use it in your own classrooms to assess the materials that you're using.
That's great. I saw so many great responses to that. Centers Indigenous people with voices and pictures, not told from a dominant cultural perspective. Yeah, and we need to hear lots of those voices, right? Because dominant cultures and voices are there for a reason. We need not just one or two, but many, many alternative perspectives, many voices.
Young people, that was something that several people mentioned, is showing young people. That's really important to show intergenerational relationships, graduations. It's great. Contemporary people and voices.
These are fantastic.
Great. Men and women, yes. No single narrative, seeing multiple perspectives, different, hearing different voices.
Cultures. I like showing joy. Yes. That's a good one. Positivity. I heard positive language being used. Yes.
Yes. Culture's ongoing. Yes.
Linked everyday things.
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm getting excited.
I am too. It's great to see. This is great. Keep going. This is fantastic. These are great.
Well, I know that people have to leave soon, so we're going to go ahead and move on to our final chat. Is there a specific action that you might take based on today's session? So go ahead and use the chat and tell us an action that you might take. And while you're doing that, just going back to the beginning, we touched on social justice and education. And part of the work that we do at the museum is helping teachers hear from and ultimately appreciate and value Native voices that have been silenced for so long. To me, silenced voices are those from tribal communities you haven't heard of. And I saw in the chat request for different tribes from the Eastern Woodlands and other places that we don't hear as much from. And we have some new materials coming, I might add. Women's voices, elders, stories, ancestral objects themselves, and future generations are young people. So creating opportunities for dialogue and raising awareness of our complex histories and our contemporary realities and bringing light to our shared history. It's not just American Native American history, it's American history. Can't happen without you. We recognize that your role of leadership in your classroom with our young people and with and as parents and with your colleagues is critical to our own healing and reconciliation in this country. I believe that the role of education is not simply to learn about math and history and science, and I know that you share that view probably, but to recognize instead the multitude of ways of seeing the world, inspiring a love of learning and finding better ways to live together equitably. So this is a work in progress, and it comes daily from both small and large actions, coordinated efforts and individual things that you may do in your classroom. Let's see what you're saying. Use lessons. Show that people of the past did not disappear. Research and highlight contemporary voices. Ask which, oh, when students say, they talk about American Indians or Native Americans, ask them, what tribe are you referring to? So getting your students to use and name communities. Use See, Think, Wonder. Talk to colleagues.
Real life voices. That's great.
Great. Meaningful land acknowledgements. Continue to work with contemporary Native people.
Mm-hmm. Learn more about the local communities where they live and work. That's fantastic.
Yeah, that is good. Good place to start. Work with young people. Mm-hmm. This is fantastic. So you've said so many good things. I mean, you may select books and resources that are written by Native people. You might vet materials for cultural sensitivity. I see start at home in all caps. Yes, these are such good strategies. Investigations. These are fantastic. So there's a variety of responses. Do a Zoom class, connect classrooms. Yeah, we'll have some field trips that will be coming up that will be online. Look for those. We have some new exciting lessons and resources that are coming, upcoming.
Yeah, somebody right, even said they, yeah, and they won't even talk. There's some great responses. I'm sorry. I'm very taken with everybody's feedback here. They're not going to use terminology in their own communities that is demeaning. So that's great.
More information on the virtual field trips. Yes, we can share some things with you down the road. Yes. Mm-hmm. This is great. You know, I won't use the word pivot because I think it's been used too much, but we're all just having to adapt to online and so you have some great ideas. Yes. So it seems like many of you will be using just some of the approaches and many more that you shared on your own and sharing in this particular chat. So you've opened up our eyes to a lot of sharing ideas with each other. We really appreciate that. We're going to go ahead and move forward. Those are just some strategies and approaches. We should have done a word cloud here, actually, Johanna, because people had such great responses. Yeah. We're going to tell you a little bit more about tomorrow. So tomorrow you'll have the opportunity to learn more about the Northern Plains History and Cultures module. It's called How Do Native Cultures and Nations Experience Belonging with Colleen Smith, who is a fantastic educator. We want to thank you for joining us today. We really hope that you'll be zooming in for Colleen's session. It should be very practical, and she's doing some differentiated strategies for your classroom. So we really hope you will join tomorrow at 1:00 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We again appreciate all the work you're doing and for joining us today, and we look forward to working with you in the future. Thank you so much.
Renee, we have a couple questions.
Okay.
Can we? All right. So one question was, what does the eagle feather mean? So I guess the question is really, why are eagle feathers so important to Native people?
Yeah, that's a good question. So it's been told to me, and I'm sure other people could layer onto this, but because eagles fly so high in the sky and they have keen eyesight, so they see things from, they see the big picture, they see a big perspective. And so they represent that vision and having that kind of foresight, I guess. They're a messenger, they're used as somebody mentioned in the chat, they're used in ceremony. Eagle feathers can be used in ceremony as a messenger to speak with the creator. And there are different words for the creator in all of our different communities. And so those are just some of the reasons. And I might add that in some communities, eagle feathers are not always used. Actually, even in my own community, we tend to use more hawk feathers and things like that. And there are certain cultural taboos we have about holding on to certain feathers at various times in our life. So it's very, very unique. But I would say generally, yes, eagle feathers because of that kind of vision and what they represent.
Thank you. Thank you. There are a couple of people from New York who are asking about resources related to the Lenape people specifically, which is exciting because we are about to launch our first lesson for fourth grade students focusing on the so-called Sale of Manhattan. And that will be available on our NK360 website in August. So look for that.
Hooray. Yay. It's very exciting. Thanks for all the feedback, everybody.
Yeah, this is great. We have a couple people that we need to thank because this would not happen without their support. So we really want to thank Kimberly McFarland and Allison Leitner from Smithsonian Enterprises. We had to vet our own images for use in today's presentation. So we give thanks to Wendy Herlock Baker, and of course from the education team, Maria Maribel Bunch and Michael Hussey and Ed Shoopman, who saw yesterday, and Catherine Hammer. Tomorrow you'll see Colleen Smith, Vilma Ortiz Sanchez, Pam Woodis, and Kenda Jenkins. So many thanks to all of their help and support with making today happen.
Thank you, everybody. Have a great rest of your day.